One important issue involves differences in clientele. I imagine that many of you might be aware of some of these key differences. So let me ask for somebody's participation on this. With regard to differences in clientele, can any of you identify some of those key differences?
More than one problem.
More than one problem, or comorbidity. Thank you. Anything else? Well, that's certainly one of the ones I wanted to talk about. The other that I wanted to mention is underrepresentation of ethnic minority clients from most of the RCTs. For example, despite the strong evidence base for trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy, TFCBT, with traumatized children, there is a dearth of evidence regarding whether it is effective with Latino or Latina children. The underrepresentation of comorbid and minority participants in those studies is especially problematic for social work practice because so many social work clients are minorities or have multiple comorbid problems. Thus, it's conceivable that even when ESTs are implemented in the same way that they were implemented in the RCTs supporting them, they simply aren't as effective with clients who differ from the RCT clients. I'm not saying that as a fact, I'm saying it's conceivable. Consequently, one implication for further bridging the gap is the need for outcome studies with the kinds of clients that social workers are most likely to serve. And this need is especially applicable to the issue of comorbidity. For example, many clients with PTSD also have a substance use disorder. In addition to knowing whether ESTs like exposure therapy are effective with PTSD, in addition to finding out if they're effective with clients with such comorbidity, we need to learn about what interventions for substance abuse they need to be combined with and in what sequence. The need for such studies is particularly serious for the large numbers of military service members now returning from Iraq and Afghanistan. This PTSD is often comorbid, not only with substance use disorders, but with other critical problems, like suicidality. These issues also have implications for concern about treatment fidelity when implementing ESTs. Maybe, just maybe, the need to implement ESTs in exactly the same way that they were implemented in RCTs might be deemed overrated. The evidence-based practice process, emphasizes the importance of practitioners integrating the research evidence with their knowledge of idiosyncratic client attributes. Therefore, in addition to worrying about whether practitioners are following treatment manuals meticulously when providing ESTs, we should be equally concerned about the need for them to modify the manualized approach to better fit those clients whose comorbidity or other attributes make them different than most clients who have participated in the research provided the empirical support. Likewise, practitioners should consider the flexibility of existing treatment protocols of ESTs when deciding whether to adopt a specific EST and whether and how to adapt it. For the same reason, another implication for bridging the gap is the need to do more effectiveness studies assessing the outcomes of interventions that are currently empirically supported, where the training and when they are provided in the context of real-world practice settings, where the training and supervision in the intervention may have been less than ideal, or where the realities in the practice setting such as level of practitioner experience or skill or caseload sizes, might be less desirable than the ideal conditions in the RCTs that provided the empirical support for the interventions. In addition, these designs should include variables derived from implementation science. To try to ferret out the processes and organizational variables that lead to the successful implementation of the interventions that are found to be effective in those settings. Likewise, as I mentioned earlier, they should assess what combinations of common elements are most associated with treatment success in settings in which one or more ESDs have been adapted. Social work should be at the forefront of this kind of research, given our emphasis on applied research in real practice settings. To facilitate this kind of research, we need to recognize how difficult and rare it is for social work researchers to use rigorous RCT designs in assessing outcome in real-world social work practice settings. For those researchers who do not opt for the route of seeking major funding for RCT studies, there is a lower-hanging fruit that I believe would be of considerable value. Less rigorous and primarily descriptive outcome studies, even some without control groups, can make an important contribution to the knowledge base about those interventions when they are provided in real-world social work practice settings. Since prior studies have already provided causal inferences about the probabilistic effectiveness of those interventions, simple pre-experimental studies can descriptively examine the level of outcome attained in real-world settings. For example, if meta-analyses have shown that on average a particular intervention or program reduces recidivism from the control group's rate of 30% to the intervention group's rate of 15%, then an agency adopting that intervention can descriptively see if its recidivism rate drops to a similar degree. Likewise, if meta-analyses have shown that an intervention tends to improve scores on an outcome measure by an average of X points, then an agency can assess the average degree of improvement among its clients who have received that intervention. Such studies would have immediate value to the agency conducting them in that they would show whether the adopted intervention is as effective in their setting and with their clients as they hoped it would be, and whether they might need to tweak it or replace it. Thus, such studies would reduce the gap between research and practice. Moreover, the studies could be aggregated to reflect the external validity and real-world effectiveness of the interventions whose original empirical support was obtained under more ideal practice conditions and with more homogeneous samples, which, by the way, might also help bridge the gap between research and practice. Such designs would also be less expensive and more feasible, as they don't require randomization and related implementation procedures, and require fewer participants to test hypotheses. Descriptively reporting effect sizes would be the focus of studies whose statistical power is weak due to a small sample size. Now, suppose a large number of these descriptive studies can be completed and reported, coupled with descriptions of the way the adapted interventions were tweaked, the common elements employed, the various organizational and practitioner attributes characterizing the practice setting, and the intervention science recommendations that were implemented to foster their fidelity. This literature could provide a basis for an ongoing inductive process using mixed qualitative and quantitative methods for developing and testing hypotheses about the conditions under which ESTs or their common elements can be made to be more feasible to implement and more effective in real-world practice settings. To clarify, I am not recommending only studies with ACT control groups. Instead, I am recommending that social work research use the best designs that are feasible in real-world practice settings. But even if a descriptive study without a control group is the only feasible option, then that study can make an important contribution too, as long as it is assessing the adaptation of an already empirically supported EST. But what will incentivize social work researchers, who typically are faculty members whose tenure and promotion require that they do more prestigious research, such as RCTs, to do the hard work of persuading agencies to undertake outcome studies of adapted ESTs, and then to do the hard work of carrying out those studies themselves without significant funding? One suggestion I have is for the editors of prestigious social work journals, like Research on Social Work Practice, to promote the submission of such studies.